gap. We just don't go and feel like, if you do feel like there's a generational gap, let's raise our hands. How many people in the room feel like there's a generational gap? So that's just about the whole room that feels like there's a generational gap. But I think I want to open up the floor for some dialogue around what are some of the problems or what are some of the solutions that cause the generational gap. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna go by hands, and I seen Bam him first. So we're gonna go with Bam first, and then I see you, and then Arnold, then DeAndre, then. I get all y'all after that.
Can you ask one more question? To follow up, for those individuals that raised your hand and said you felt that there was a generational gap, how many of you do you all feel that that generational gap is problematic in our community?
So, Bam.
I don't need that. I got a deep voice. I personally feel like it's a generational gap because I think with the older generation, they kind of did their thing and they kind of stepped away from the scene for a while. And the younger generation has came in and they kind of doing their thing and they're elevating it. But when it seems like some of the old heads decide to pop back out, it's a respect level that is not given to the people who were doing it before them. I think a lot of the problem is between the older generation and the younger generation is just a level of respect, because I think we always have to give props to the people that came before us, and I think that's not happening today. So I think that's what's causing the disconnect. And the older people just don't want to come out. And it just comes to the point that some of the old heads just don't come out and support ballroom anymore. So it's like it's changing. The time is changing. Everything changes every 10 to 15 years anyway. Even fashion does. So I just think ballroom changes every 10 to 15 years. And I just think some people are just, you know, excluded from the fold of the change.
So to go to Harold's second question, would you say that there's a problem in the generational gap? Is it problematic for you?
There's no problem for me because I connect with both generations. You know what I'm saying? So I know how to pull and play, and I know how to do checks and balances. So it's about how you put yourself in between the generations. I believe I'm cool with everybody as long as they cool with me. I can keep it neutral. You know what I'm saying? But I just think sometimes with the older generation, they just expect that respect because of who they are. You know what I'm saying? And it's weird. It's weird.
So really quick, as a new overall father, you kind of answered it, but you didn't. Do you feel that it is problematic now? You spoke for yourself, but you're leading a whole house of people at this point. So you can no longer look at just yourself. You have to look at everyone that you're leading as well as the rest of the community. So do you feel the generational gap is problematic or not?
Well, I can still say, even as an overall father, even before I took that position, I connected with a lot of people from both generations. So it still has to be primarily about me. I don't see it as a disconnect for myself because I connect with everybody. Now, I can't speak for everybody else. They might see it as a disconnect for them because maybe they can't play on both sides of the fence. I actually connect in both places. I deal with majority of everybody in the House of Ebony, from the old to the youngest. So I feel like I'm connected. I only can speak for me. I'm connected. I can't speak for everybody else. It's not a problem for me.
Okay. Okay. So we got Antoine, Arnold, and then DeAndre, and then I don't got any hands after that. We're going to go to them people first.
I personally don't feel like there's a generation gap. I believe that as leaders, as veterans in this ballroom scene, we fail to put into our younger generation what we have already done, what has happened before us, where we're trying to go. The new generation, in my opinion, I believe they're just here for the excitement. So when we put on these lives, when we look at these YouTube clips and things of that nature, these are new generation individuals who are excited of trying to do what we are doing, what we've been doing, or the talent that we had to put out there and showcase. When they come in, when we induct them into our homes, our houses, we fail to do as parents, as when we were kids. When you go to a new school, you feel new amongst new people. So unless you're putting that information to the young generation as to what we're trying to do, where we come from, how this come about, they don't know what to do, what to expect. They're here for what they see on social media that in their minds they know how to do or they want to do or they look forward to doing.
Yes, you know, I know something wrong, something wrong.
I certainly think there's a generational gap. I'm glad you guys have this conversation because as Deion said earlier, from the House Lives Matter conference that we had last week in Dallas, it was one of the initiatives that we brought up, one of the things that we were touching on. And we put out a question to viewers and on Facebook, and we also had it on the radio show, the Iconic Point of View, where people came on and expressed what they thought. But there was a couple of things that they, that a lot of folks said, and that participated or made this a generational gap. They thought parenting was a problem. They thought leadership was a problem. There were even folks who said things in terms that, you know, even people who were in their, say, 23 to 27 felt a generation gap for the people that are younger than them, from 16 to 23. So everybody sees a generational gap. But it's not being addressed because of certain, maybe because people don't want to identify that there is one. And certainly it's problematic because we can tell, one of the things James says, yes, I'm gonna be considered one of the younger folk. You know, because there's a viewpoint from that vantage point that it's a different set of things that they're going through and a different set of things that they're looking towards finding. And it's not merging with what older folks have been doing. And so if they can merge that, it's going to be a certain still problem.
I appreciate that.
Next we have DeAndre.
It's problematic, for sure.
Hello, everyone. My opinion, I do feel ballroom is a generational gap. Only because when I came out, you had the older people with the quotations, how they say now, was more nurturing. They took you in, you actually lived with them. It was a little more guidance, to my opinion. And yes, we took that and ran with it and was able to develop and took ballroom and took our own stride and made the best that we could out of it. With the newer generation is not getting all that, in my opinion, not all of what we received. And a lot of them are saying, like Antoine was saying, only on YouTubes and clips. They only see the performance of this person on a clip, but they didn't know how this person nurtured the past generation and brought that person up. And the newer generation is like, well, we can do the same thing you did. We can be the best performer on the floor and shine that kind of way to get your applause, not knowing what we did in the back, what they did in the background to us. And I do believe it's problematic for me is because it makes the scene divided. The younger generation is fighting against the older generation, and the older generation want to fight against the younger generation, where we're all one generation and ballroom is one as a whole. And I think that's the segregation in the younger generation and the older generation.
I'm gonna take a few more before we go into the panelists. Some of the younger generation people raise their hand. I've seen Koi, I've seen Jennifer, and I see you. I'm gonna go to Koi first and Jennifer.
I don't think I'm not saying there's a gap between generation. I think that we're choosing to make this gap. A lot of people when they get power, they take advantage of their power instead of nurturing a lot of the kids and stuff, especially me because I came when I was 17. So I was not, it's not that I'm looking for excitement out of the scene. I was just looking for something I wasn't getting from home. And then when I got in the scene, it was a whole nother thing. It was an exploitation because there was a lot of old people that saw weakness in a lot of younger people. So they took advantage of that. And and they use a lot of leaders in high position use their power to prey on their kids. And it's at this point, this is why there's such a gap, because a lot of the younger generation are scared to be around y'all because we don't feel comfortable.
That's deep.
Jennifer?
I like to think of things in the spectrum of how I grew up. So I grew up, as I like to say, I got introduced in 2010. I met Selvin. I walked the ball. She became my mother. I moved to Atlanta, I think, that next year. I met Andre. I met a few other nurturing people within the scene. And though we speak more so definitely about what they do and their characters and how they move, I also feel that us as the younger generation take the responsibility to look at what we're doing and what we want out of the scene. I keep saying that at these panels because there are some things now that have changed from back then. Like you have a bigger way to look at ballroom and what you want to get out of ballroom and then what you want to give back to ballroom. So for me, I see the generational gap, but I do not let that take away from me learning and respecting and honoring those who have come before us and to honestly idolize and still want to be like these people in theory from what I thought, and then taking away those pieces that may not be as fruitful for what I want to do in life.
Come on,
so we have Corinne, then Kevin, then him, and then we're going to go to the panel, and then we'll get some questions after we allow the panel to speak.
I do believe that there is a generational gap in ballroom, and I think that it is problematic. We won't see how problematic it is until like the newer generation is the older generation, and they are hearing ballroom. However, I think that like I've even been told, and I joined ballroom to be not for the glitz and glam of what it offers, but because I didn't know any trans. Where I came from, there was no trans community, and I wanted to connect and learn from other trans women who have walked in my shoes and knew and learned things that they've already lived. But getting into the scene, I never got that. I have probably become more friends with butch queens than I have with any trans woman, and I've indirectly been told, like it was said to someone else, and that person told me that they don't want to. It was somebody that I kind of wanted to reach out to and gain knowledge from, and she kind of was like, no, I don't really deal with the younger girls because if I say something to the younger girl, she doesn't take my advice, and all of a sudden it's like that she can't. Oh, that older girl can't take me, and stuff like that. It's like that's not fair because to me, ballroom is like a school, and the older people are like teachers, and you know, in order for us to grow, there's always going to be those students that talk back and don't and aren't really there to learn, but there's also those students that are here to learn. And I feel like not giving us opportunities because you shun people for like, you know, making mistakes and doing things that they probably shouldn't have, it doesn't mean that there aren't other people out here that can benefit from your guidance. Mm-hmm.
I think the generational gap comes from a lot of, like DeAndre was saying, the nurturing and stuff. We don't have that anymore in the ballroom scene because we don't have mothers in the scene anymore, because every mother is a trophy mother, and they're not here to nurture the kids, because the only thing that we have them for in the house is what categories they're going to walk and what they can bring to the floor. If you have mothers that's going to actually be mothers and be here for their kids on the floor and off the floor, then we can have that nurturing back in the ballroom scene and stop just putting mothers that are trophy mothers that can bring a trophy to your house and not be here to bring the kids up the way they should be brought up, like they was brought up back in the days.
Come on, Kelly.
So, I kind of echo like almost like everything that like everybody said. I don't know. Like, I kind of feel like, well, James said he was in the younger generation, but I feel like we're kind of like Genovese said, it's kind of like, I feel like it's a mix, because there's a whole nother generation kind of after us at this point. And I feel like our generation is kind of stuck, we were stuck in the middle for a long time. It's kind of like, we got the nurturing, we got that part, we did get that part. But then it was kind of like, some of us did do the nurturing to others, there was some of us who didn't do the nurturing because I think they kind of felt defeated and they felt like, well, you know what? I don't know if this is gonna necessarily get me anywhere, or either like these people just aren't, this older generation is not getting it. And so they kind of gave up and they just became complacent, which from listening to other people's comments, I feel like some people feel like the older generation got to at one point. So one of the things that they talk about in Dallas is like, just at some point you have to like allow other people to do stuff as well. And I think, like, when you look at James and you see like he went ahead and he just went ahead and did his own thing. And I think that honestly, like, you know, I have ties to Osai. However, I mean, I think it's commendable because, I mean, I think he's seen a vision and he did what he felt he needed to do from the nurturing that he got from the generation before him to be able to nurture the next generation. And that's kind of what has to happen to a certain extent.
Nice. So I think that Dante made a good segue into the next hour to talk to the judges because the James was created, he's self-proclaimed to be in the new generation, but also he just created his own house. And I wanted to give you a chance to, if you had anything that you wanted to respond to anything anybody said, before I ask you a question.
I have so much to say. I think okay, so we can start. I can start just from the top. Like respect, like the very first thing that like stood out to me was how the respect should be given from the younger generation to the older generation. I can speak for myself and maybe for a couple other people. I know if this, like Kay said, was a school, we had people who's a little bit mouthy. I was one of those mouthy people who felt like authority or not, you're going to respect me just like I'm going to respect you. And that's where I fall short with the older generation. We are like I felt like I was put into a box where it was like, this is what we did, but this is what you're not going to do. And it was like kind of like the same situation. It was like, I'm pretty sure with the older generation being where I was at some point in time, they did this stuff and they had to answer to somebody else. I don't know if that was a nurturing answer or what it was, but I just refused to put them at a place where I felt like I couldn't do what I felt was best for me or my generation. With all of the things I've done, I felt like I had to break a barrier. I wasn't doing it because somebody else was doing it. I was doing it because everybody else was scared of me. And because I felt like it was okay, it was right, and it was not going to hurt anybody. If anything, it was just going to be an explanation to me. I'd do nothing without an explanation. So I feel like when it comes down to me being a part of the younger generation or the middle generation, wherever I am, I feel like I'm not going to do anything about a blueprint and it making sense. So once this blueprint is done and it fits, it makes sense to everybody to make it make sense. Because everybody's watching me do it and they're saying, this is what you cannot do because this is us and this is you. So along with respect is whether you are 50 years older than me or 10 years older than me, don't tell me I can't do something. That's not harming you just because you're intimidated about what power I hold when you're doing it. Or the fact that I'm 28, I can't be a leader. Or I'm not a legend, so I can't lead people. I've been leading people since I was 18. Like, the minute I became an adult, I felt like I was the person that was supposed to make a difference with the people around me, whether that was in or outside the walls. And I feel like I've done a really, really good job.
To address that and also to address everything that was said, I think one of the greatest problems in listening, of course there is a generational gap in ballroom. We have people participating in ballroom that were walking balls in the 70s. It's 2018. So naturally there is a generational gap. What I think really is more problematic than the gap itself is we have become so conditioned in ballroom to allow people to generalize things and make them the norm of what's going on. For the longest time, ballroom has been put down. You know, if you participated in ballroom, we were shamed. And we continuously in this scene do that. It is not the older generation that's, there are people in the older generation that are problematic and not respectful of the new generation. There are some people that are young that do not show respect to the older generation. That is not the entire generation. And we continuously do this. We take things and we generalize them and make them the norm for the entire community. And that's not the case. You know, there are a lot of people here, you know, that are, and throughout all of them that I can name, that are of my generation, that interact well with the younger generation. And you know, and even you know, you look at at James, and I disagree with you. I don't feel that you're disrespectful. I think that you're confident. But another thing too is that people tend to want things just given to them. Okay, people say, oh well, these leaders should step aside. When realistically, like I can go through. If you want to believe, you do things to show that you. James showed that he was a leader in the house of Khan by bringing in talent, by going places. Dante showed himself as a leader, not only in Balenciaga, but as throughout the community. Mo, you have different people do that. But then you hear people say, well, these old leaders need to step aside. But if you're not doing anything to exhibit you should be a leader, who's gonna turn their house over to you? For you to fail, and then then that individual has to come back and rebuild what they put 15, 20 years in, and you've destroyed in 15, 20 months. So in order to, and I don't want to be long winded, but in order to be able to take over and stuff like that, you have to put people over, you have to show people, you have to build trust in your community. People are here because they trusted Dante. If James were to do something, people will come support because they trust him. You can't just feel like, oh well, I came out when he did and do no work and expect the same accolades. In the same way, I can't be in the seat. I can't get up every morning and get on Facebook and read the new generation and then expect them to respect me.
Right. Well,
just maybe one of few. And the up and coming people that were around me, it was basically, I was living in the undershadows with them. So it's something like piggyback off of what Kelly said, is there's no more nurturing. It's almost like in the 70s and the 80s when our real parents got mixed up in drugs and crack cocaine and stuff like that, and grandmama had to step in and raise the children and stuff like that. Drugs was a big part of when I was coming out. And going into now, that's what a lot of the nurturing has been lost too. There are some good leaders and parents out there, but it's the nurturing that has been gone. And even with me, with bridging the gap between trans women who have progressed into new womanhood, or back then, Medicaid wasn't so ready accessible. And back then we had to basically put in blood, sweat, and tears. So when a younger generation comes and they ask for the advice and they don't receive it is what we think that they should, and they dismiss it, then that can be offensive to some people. And I know a lot of people who felt this though 10 years ago, you went and got your change, and this thing, why is you still participating in ballroom? You're doing this and you're doing that, but this is where I come from. I've been part of this community. You can't shut me out because now I have this thing between my legs or whatever you feel I'm supposed to be. You can't put me in a box. And that's basically what it's all about, is everyone comes into their own strides. You always have to be the underdog at whatever part that you're doing. I felt like that. I'm quite sure Andre's felt like that. Everyone has felt like that, but I'm here, and I've always been that type of person who's able to reciprocate things back. And whoever has advice for me, I'm very transparent, and I'm here. So.
My dear sister, I know you spoke about being in the middle of the generations, which some of us feel like we are in the middle generations. And what do you feel the difference between our generation?
add on to what Kelly was saying, I think that there is a huge issue with the values in which men value women in the scene, or trans women in the scene specifically, and I think that that is a big piece in which how people are coming up. If we're losing that figure that is the nourisher, then of course there's going to be a divide in the way in which people are growing up. A lot of people can't always attach themselves to men, and they always deflect or like move themselves toward the women in the scene. So to have a space in which women are not being valued, of course there's going to be this disconnect, and of course there's going to be people that grow up not necessarily feeling like they have a placement in ballroom at all. If anything, definitely to add to what Deja was saying, people are saying, oh, well, you got in your surgery, so now you need to move on, or because, oh, you're a professional girl, like this isn't a space for you, or because you have an opinion and you're not being valued as a human, this seems to be some tension between how you actually can evolve. And so I think that a large issue is that people don't necessarily see the wholeness of individuals. They value them to see what they can attract from them, how you can win a trophy for me. Like, you know, there are needs and wants that we all need as human beings. And I think that if we as people value ourselves as holistic people, then we would definitely figure out those ends in which how we interlink and accept each other and can uplift each other and support each other to grow on to the next level, or to get ourselves in a sustainable place where people are willing to step up and take over a house, or willing to step up and, you know, see the next person next to them and be like, oh, I can welcome myself to you, I can say hi to you at any point. You know, I think that there is like many multitudes of like attitudes that are developed because of the systems that we've created within ballroom. And not that they're anyone's fault, but you know, like I said, as we all, we have needs and wants as well too. There are people from an older generation that want to be valued, and their only sense of value is through their, is through being in a position of power. There are younger people that are aiming for that, or there are young people that haven't been able to grasp that power yet, so they're fighting for that, you know? And yeah, I think that that's my perspective on that.
Andre, you stated that you feel that you are one of the people from the old generation that can mix well and have mixed well with the new generation. What are some of the things that you have done over the years to be able to, if you will, bridge the gap?
Well, my whole 30 years of being in ballroom, I never stopped, so I was in both. I was both in, half of the people that I'm around or even be around is W and under. Half of my house that I run around with is W and under. Half of my friends that I be in ballroom is W and under. Don't get me wrong, I grew up from the Pepper Libations, you know, so I respect them as well. I don't believe that it's, you know, I think it's both. I think the young generation is a headache. The old generation is a headache. Why I think some of the old ones are is because they don't be out here. So how are you going to come out here and you want so much respect, but then you don't even want to give respect? So I understand that as well. But then you have the knuckleheads that's really young that, you know, don't give a fuck about no one that is old, period, even if they paved the way or they are respectful, period. So you run through both. I would never sit here and say that the young generation is just, you know, just out there and just saying, fuck everybody, because there's a lot of them that is respectful. But then you have some of the old ones that are doing the same thing. So I think it's just a bridge that both need to be fixed. I think both sides need to really look at this. You know, I'm one of those that always try to step out of my cue to look at it through your shoes or my shoes to try to get the best out of whatever that situation is. This is the problem that we have. A lot of people don't want to step out of nothing. They just want to go by, you know, what they do is right. And it's not always right. As many days I've said stuff and I've done stuff and I woke up and said, no, bitch, you was wrong. You need to apologize. You need to do something. Because sometimes it don't matter. We're human. Everybody can be wrong. It's just to know that you're wrong and try to fix that situation. That's the problem that we have. The problem that we have for the young generation and the old that we need to bridge together to make this as one. There's no such thing as I've been out 30 years, so bitch, don't be, you know, you can't say shit to me. No, I'm human just like you are, so we both have to figure this out. And if we can't figure this out, it's never going to get better, period. Because you need the young generation because that's what goes on. You need the old bitches to teach some of the young ones for it to go on. You know what I mean? And then one more thing, I would never leave my house to no one until I'm completely respected 100% for that person to take my 30 years of boardroom somewhere. I'm not gonna just give my house, like they say, you should just leave and give it to, not always, right, bitch. You know? At the end of the day, if I don't have someone to give it to, I'm not giving it to them. And at the end of the day, I feel like I am respected 100%. I am one of those that's not gonna disrespect anybody. I don't care if you're 1 year old to 100. I'm not gonna disrespect you unless you disrespect me. I'm one of those people. My mother taught me that before they taught me borrow. You get it? So at the end of the day, this is what all of us need to do. Because that's what it is. It's about respect. It's about human. If you cannot do that, we will never get anywhere. Because at the end of the day, everybody deserves respect. Regardless if I don't like you, if you say hi to me, I'm going to say hi back because you gave me your breath. I could say in the back of my mind, I don't know why he spoke, you know, because he really don't like me. But I'm going to speak back because you spoke to me. That's a part of respect. It's not about, oh, this bitch spoke to me, girl, please. No, it's not that serious. Because at the end of the day, we all need to realize this same person that you did not speak to, you might need. You could have a heart attack. You could fall on the street. You could get hit by a car. Anything can happen. This could be the only bitch walking past you.
And I'm going to keep walking.
So at the end of the day, we all need to fix this. It's not about the young generation, and it's not about the old. We are one community here. Born. So at the end of this is unity. We have to fix it, find a way. That's all I have to say.
What? She gonna be the next RR.
I could never.
I try to build certain people, but if you can't respect me to build you, then I'm gonna let that go. I tried 3 different times. And you know what really kills me sometimes? They say, oh, don't go out of your house, da 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 da, because this is the bread and you're supposed to groom this one. So when you try to groom that person and they slap you in the face so many times, I don't want no one to take over. Don't get me wrong, you can't be an Andre. I'm not saying Andre's the best thing either, bitch. You know, but you, no one can be an Andre. I don't want you to be an Andre if you're gonna take over my house. I want you to be you, but I want you to be respected and moral. I want you to at least have 2 or 3 categories. I want you to be a man or a woman that's respected worldwide for that situation that we're building. You get it? And if you cannot do that, then you cannot take that position until I feel that you are worthy. I personally feel like
as a leader, your job is captivating other leaders. So in 30 years, if you couldn't create a leader.
But 30 years I wasn't a parent, it was 26,
okay? I'm
truthfully 26 years. I'm not even gonna say I was a leader before that. I wasn't truthfully a leader at 26 years because I was still learning. When I opened the house of Ms. Ryan 26 years ago, I didn't feel like I was a leader. I was doing something because I wanted to do it to see if it would work. I didn't even know where it was going. So I couldn't even say, if I was gonna say how many years I was a leader to me, I would say 20.
So I think that the thing that the lady said in the beginning is that should thing, we can't should anybody's life, because what somebody would do for their house is completely different. That may be part of the problem, but we'll expound on that when we get to that space.
But I have one thing to say. Why do people always put someone else's shoes on? Saying, okay, I'm in the house of Mizrahi. If you're not a Mizrahi, you don't know what's going on here. So a lot of people always sit here and say, oh, Andre don't want to give up. First of all, I can give somebody overall because I'm the founder. That takes nothing from me. Take everything. I'm Andre. That's enough for me. I don't even need a last name.
This is not the Mizrahi group. Calm down.
I have built myself a name, a legacy, enough to never need a house of Mizrahi or anything because I would never be forgotten for Borrow. So when somebody say, oh, Andre, why you don't want to give it up? I don't have no one to give it to. Because I even thought about people outside of different houses, and I said, well, this person didn't jump from 5 houses in 2-3 years. I don't want them to come here and do the same thing. So they might look, you know, they might be powerful, or they might do this or do that, but at the same time, they're not fit for me to be the king for Ms. Rahi until I feel less than.
And that's fine. I think
stop throwing shots at Tim Malone.
It's more of a statement. I think people feel privileged. Houses are not publicly traded companies. These are private houses. This is theirs. This is yours. This is something that's been groomed. And if this is something that you want, you step to the plate and you do it. You take it. It's not something that's just going to be given to you. You can't expect an accolade when you haven't done anything to be, given the honors for. Does that make sense to everybody?
Yeah.
So when you're asking for something, you don't normally just ask for food. You say, I'm hungry, and you find that food. So if you're hungry for this house, if you're hungry for that position, if you're hungry for that growth, you have to take it. It's not something that's just going to be given to you or handed down to you. I think anybody on that panel that I've learned from, I've gone to them. I've learned from them because I was hungry for it. So you have to be hungry for more than just the title. You have to be hungry for that title. You have to be hungry for the experience that you're going to get from it. You got to be hungry for the work that you have to put into it. And so that's all.
But also running a company, when you have a CEO in the company, you also have a board. And the board can then eventually dethrone the CEO. You know,
This man, each evolved from a house. That man there evolved from a house and evolved from a house. He's a starting house. There are so many people in the scene that say, oh, well, this one should do this. There's no limit in ballroom in the number of houses. Start your own.
Start your
own. So it's that are leaders, because, I mean, Charles, you know, the house isn't always the easiest thing.
Oh, shit.
They just want the title. They don't want nothing to
right.
The work.
You don't want the calls at 4 in the morning. You don't want meeting the nice date, and the date wants to go out, but you know you just don't promise the rock star of your house that you're going to go judge this ball in Chicago that she's walking grand prize.
So then,
and now you have to go.
So I want to give Shannon a chance to talk.
I want to just with level, but then I tell you what, that's a different angle than somebody older, and I mentioned Andre's generation. Let's take ball models. There's something that happened in the scene, our scene, Black gay men, that didn't affect. First of all, back in the 80s when AIDS came out, a lot of the people that we came out with, they died. When you get AIDS, it was a death sentence. You found out yesterday someone had AIDS, the next week you were burying them. That's what we dealt with in our generation. There was no medicine. It was like you get AIDS, you were planning a funeral, they were gone. You're like, I was just partying with her. A week later, you're gone. That was our mindset. So that whole generation wiped away. That Paris, like, and Pepper, they're gone. The ballroom was wiped out. We had to figure out how we would do this thing. There was no one to show us. There was no one to look to. It was like just us. There was no YouTube. There was no social media. It was just us going out there like we got taken around. Also with that, as Black gay men, with that being gone, there was no symbol of what a middle-aged Black gay man is. You guys don't know because you're too young. We're setting the trend. We're trying to figure it out. What it is to be a middle-aged Black gay man in this world, or a trans woman, or whatever, middle age, because everybody else was wiped out before us. They died, unfortunately. And the few that are around don't come out. When we sit there, and I know from my house, that was from my angle, me, Whitney, Julie, and Fred, that is our whole mission, to show our members what it is to be a middle-aged Black gay man so we have something to look forward to and say, this is what we're supposed to do. So when we sit there, and I tell my members in my house, I'm not your girlfriend. I'm not. I'm not going to party with you. I'm here to show you what to do and guide you. Your friends, mother, that's your girlfriends. Now, as far as leadership, I'm here to show you what to do. Everybody here knows every house has a person that they pass it on to. I will tell you, as a founder of my house, I tell anybody, if you want to do this, let you know. When they say Garcon, blah, 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 just like they say Balenciaga, when they say Garcon, I know that's me. When y'all read, that's indirectly. When you say Balenciaga, that's Harold. We know that. We take on that role. If you want to be the leader of the house, you're going to take on the role when they read you, good or bad. You're going to take on the role when I get the call at 3 o'clock in the morning. Listen, I got to go to the hospital. I can't tell my parents, so-and-so right here. Can you take me? I get out the bed and I go. When you want to sit there, someone dies, and there's a funeral money right there, who's getting the money? We got members right down in North Carolina. Who's going to get the money together? Who's going to get and rally the call? This is what we do. It's hard. It's hard as hell. When you can't pay your rent, you look to your parent right there and say, hey, you know what? You're older. You're supposed to have your shit together. I'm coming to you. So you got to step up and say, you know what? I'm going to help you out. The ballroom part, I tell anybody, that's 5% of this shit. That's 5% of this shit. That's why I've been paid no more right there. I said, Twiggy, that's what I'm deeming. And I sit here and say, you know what? I'm going to train you how to do this. I'm going to show you how to do this. And there are times when she sat there and she told me, she's like, this is fucking hard as shit. When young members don't want to listen to you because they feel you're the same age. I came out with you. I don't want to listen to you. But she's doing the work. When old members, and we had this wisdom way, but old members said, you're too young. I don't want to listen to you. But you know what? You're old, but you didn't do the work. She's doing the work. We have to stand behind them, but at the same time, you have to earn it. On the other thing, Charles, you said about HIV, and I got your word. In our generation, if we look at this, we assume everybody got HIV in our generation.
True.
That's just a fact. It's like, you got it, bro, you got HIV. It's not a big thing right here. So we sit there and say, okay, you got this. I'm like, what else you got? You got diabetes? You got angles or something? We sit there, that's what we talk. So it's not a matter of, it doesn't confine us, because we knew back when we came out, when someone got HIV, they were gone. You guys, it's a chronic disease. We grew up when it was a death sentence.
And see, that's my thing. If it was a death sentence, how can you so quickly come on out?
Well, I can't speak for who you talk to.
No, I know you do.
I just want to say that there are people out there.
I'm just in front of you. How can you so flippantly
because they're hurt.
Right.
There are hurt people. They're carrying a lot of hurt. They're carrying a lot of bitterness. And back then and there, back in the day, that was the way when you were hurt to hurt somebody, to be religious and say stuff like that. And so unfortunately, as Donkin's on the tail end of, you know, speaking in a different context about what we allow our parents to do, grandparents to step, whatever, in the same way, we have to tell these people, that's not acceptable, right?
Yeah. And you know what, I want to add one thing on,
you know,
wait, I want to add one thing on this and talk to you, right, because we have some super side. One thing, as an older person, I know I had to do, and I'll tell anyone, my daughter's where you're in, and I had to sit back, I had to check my own business. I'll be honest with you, I had to check my own business. Because I know, I was saying to myself, I said, you know what, when I came up, I got beat up, everything for being gay, all this so-and-so, and now this generation coming to get flowers. And I had to sit back and say, you know what, don't be bitter, be happy. Let them get some flowers. They're coming through, they're doing non-profit stuff. We didn't have all this opportunity. Yeah. And so some girls in our generation, we sit back and we see all the stuff that, we didn't have none of this. And y'all have that. Some girls like, I want a piece. And you think like, you know what, I'm 40 or 50. That's not my demographic. And you have to sit back and be like, you know what? I'm good with being my age right here. Let y'all do it. I'm going to support you and your thing and your endeavor and this generation. And that's a hard thing to swallow. Everybody at that level. And I know I had to do that. And I had to sit back there and say, you know what? Let me check my bitterness and sit back and be like, that's when y'all see me at a ball sometimes. Because, like, I don't need to be there.
Right.
Come on,
I don't need to be there. Y'all let me on YouTube. Send me pictures and everything else. I'm going to bed at 9. But I'm working on what I expect to report.
So the conversation, the panel is talking about, is there a generational gap? And so Marquise brought the perfect point. So in 30 years, you haven't found anyone that you've been, mentoring, that you've mentored all these years. You've not found anyone to take over. So they're their problem. That's their problem. So in 30 years, you haven't found anybody that you want to take over. And then he says, start your own thing. But you put 50 people in the house. And you put 50 people in. Let me finish and you can rebut me. And you, but you put all these folk in the house saying that these are the people I want. I want Charles and I want Mo and I want all these people to come and do this. I want little James. I want little James. But no, you can't be the father, little James. You can't be the father, Marquise. You can't be, how is that? So you wonder why there's a generational gap. And it's not just because of positions and power that they want. You've not given them the respect that you're talking about. But you say, just start your own. Don't worry about it, start your own. Why did I come to you in the beginning?
I could have started now before I came to you.
I got something to say.
Honestly, my comment, is very, very similar to Arnold. And my thing is that when you have somebody like Lil James, and they go in and they start their own thing, and then you have a lot of the older generation that are then reading him and talking about, oh, child, he can't do this. Oh, this is not going to happen. Oh, why would he do this? Oh, he was next in line. Oh, da 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 da. But it wasn't happening. So then he did start his own thing. But then it goes back, but then people still are reading. So the thing is, at the end of the day, like, you can't say, like, well, if you're not ready to get there, then start your own shit, and I'm not ready to give it to you. But then they do, and then there's still stuff to say. So I just echo, honestly, what Arnold's saying.
I got to add to that right quick. Let me tell you, when you start your own house, I don't care how iconic you are, that's hard work. The ballroom, let me tell you, we have a finite amount of resources in ballroom, period. This is supply and demand. You have a finite amount of resources. When I left Mugler, there was nobody out there trying to be a garçon at all. I was the first one. When you left the club, there wasn't a lot. You had to sell it. And the first thing you do, you start, people start coming from other places. When you did yours, same thing. That's it, because there's no endless group of walkers out there. And the ballroom doesn't like new houses, period. The ballroom, you know why? Because it's competition. And they know, the old houses know that you're, the old houses know you're taking members from them. And there's a fear there. That when you start a new house, that members are going to leave the old houses to go with you. Because people like something new. If they see a vision they want to go with, they're going to go with that. So the woman wants to shut that down. They did that to me as garçon. They did that to me. I remember. I was a Mugler. I know this happens to every. It's not uniquely. This is what happens. This is the growing pains. When Ms. Rocky started, it was the same thing. When Prodigy started, it was the same. Every house happens. Balmain, everything. The test of time is, after you've been there, you withstood that, and you get to see that same, like, you know what? I did it. That's the moment. And the hard part of letting that go is because after you created that and you've been through the hard times, that you've been on a panel and you sat there and you fought for your kids, right there, you said that I created this, I want to make sure this legacy lasts as what I want it to be.
So is that why it's so hard to let it go?
That's why I'm explaining it, right? Right, because you have a vision. When you start a house, you have a vision of what the house is. You want that vision to pass on. Now you know and you want to continue. And I sit there and I grapple with this. I grapple with this all the time because I have to sit there and say to my members, no, this is not my vision. At the same time, I have to sit back and allow that you are a different person and you have a different vision. I'm going to let that go right there. I have to sit back. I may not like it, but I have to say, I'll have to suck pickles and sit over here and let these girls do what they want to do.
So as long as you're
right, compromise. Compromise. And that's it.
No, it's one more reason Autumn, this is the reason why. How many people stays in the house to even nurture them? After 3 to 4 years, they are out. In my house, I might have 7 people that's here from the beginning, and everybody else is new from the next 3 to 4 years or 5 years. You can't even have one person stay here because another house, they want to hop to this one or hop to that one. So you don't have time to nurture them.
But that goes back to the nourishing. Well,
you know,
why they pop it from one house
follow,
to another.
Follow.
When you pop.
That's the bridging of the gap. You know, when we all started out, your name was your house. That was your name.
Right. And you were staying.
And you were staying there for 15, 20, you know, 30
now,
years.
But now it's more like, if you don't like what they did, let me just jump to the next house because then I can do better.
So it comes all of us by bridging the gap.
All right, y'all. I want to respect everybody's time. I appreciate everybody so much. Thank you so vocal. We're going to take a few more questions. So if you have any questions, go Antoine.
First, let's just understand, just because you're a mother or a father, that doesn't make you a parent. Just because you have people in the position to learn, take after you, doesn't mean that they have the ability to do exactly that. We have a president in office who don't know how to govern. So just because you pick up individuals to teach and train them, doesn't mean they're gonna come out to be that person that you want to train. At the end of the day, we all can say, I want this person to leave my house after I'm done.
But at the same token, we all grow in years. So how I feel when I first got in is not how I'm gonna feel after 15 years of being in. So my whole demeanor might change. So I can understand where Andre comes from when having 30 people in the house and he doesn't want to choose now. At the end of the day, you have people in your house. We all can sit here and say there are people in our house that we don't see fit. We have people in our house who wants to be there because of the name.
That's it. Mm-hmm.
So just because you have a house of 200 and more.
Or driving.
I'm just simply saying. Everybody's not here to lead. Everybody cannot lead. So, I mean, no matter how much you put into trying to teach somebody or learn somebody, some people just not that comprehensive of trying to take that. Some people are just here to be a part of the entertainment, and that's just what it is.
Good job. We're gonna go to Rocky, then Boyd, then we're gonna get it close to Rocky. Yeah.
Well, I had a question, because I think a lot of times in these spaces, I wanna kind of talk about what Corinne's point brought up, and I wanna ask the trans woman question. So Corinne talks about nurturing. And in speaking to younger women in the scene and watching younger women in the scene, how they identify, and talking to older women in the scene, as far, and when I say women, I'm talking about our transgender women, okay? I wanted to ask, because I think that even the way Kelly, Ayana, and then we have girls more than north side of transition, they don't call you girls old. One of the things that I've heard and I've talked to with women, transgender women, is it seems as if like the older girls, when they transition, it was their mindset that very, okay, I'm transitioning and I'm blending into society. I'm not waving no flag, this, that, or anything. It seems with a lot of the younger women that are transitioning that they're comfortable identifying as, hey, I'm a transgender woman. You know, so I wanted to bring this up in this space to kind of add, since we had a balance here, is that a philosophical difference?
It's the times. It's when I came out, it was all about stealth. You know, how could you, you know, it was all about stealth at the end of the day, all about realness. You know, when I came out, it was, if you got an F on your ID at the DMV or motor vehicles, it's because you passed at the counter, not because the law said that I had to put it on there. You know what I'm saying? And nowadays, it's because Medicaid is so ready accessible, it's okay because I've mown for a year and I went and got my bags and the law says you got to call me a woman, I'm a woman. And that's fine, and that's all fine and dandy, but at the end of the day, you can't rush certain things. You get what I'm saying? And it's the test of times. It's 2018. You know, when you look on Love and Hip Hop and you see Miss Nikki Baby and all of those girls like that, they were emulating us back then. So now you have the girls trying to emulate them, and you're getting androgynous, and it's like, okay, you're moving too fast, you're not taking your time. And we're living in a society where it's more openly, you know what I'm saying, as far as when you're dealing with men to be a trans woman. However, within the community, there's still a lot of shame. You know, with the girls, we are our own worst enemies. Auntie Octavia said it the best, because we stay among our cliques, and if you're not with the cliquey girls, then you're not in. And then, you know, the male figures have been doing it to us for a long time. And so, you know, back then it was, oh, Miss Dane, you know, you have your puss, and why are you still going around and doing these, you know, these faggy things, and this, that, and third. I've been in cunt settings, cis settings, whatever type of settings that you want, but if I can't be myself in the LGBT community, then where can I be myself at if people are going to shame me? You know, It's so, all about waking up comfortable and being who you
want to
be.
No, I was just wanting to say, but does that kind of deter older girls from not helping younger girls?
It doesn't, it because it has to deal with people being conditioned to think a certain way. Because, you know, 10 years ago when I got it, I didn't want to come to the scene because I didn't think that the scene would receive me. You get what I'm saying? Because some people have a higher opinion of where you should be. You know what I'm saying? They think, and it's not such a bad thing all the time. Oh, this thing, I see you Murray with the basketball player. And this, because you went and laid down and had an operation, your credit score is still going to be the same. Niggas still going to be niggas. You still going to be this and that, going through jobs, whatever it is. It does not make a difference. You know what I'm saying?
I don't want to silence anybody. I'm definitely for everybody to have a voice. I don't want anybody to leave here feeling like they wasn't able to go on and say what they want to say in this space. We will have space to revisit a lot of these conversations tomorrow. What I want everybody to do is kind of think about some action plans and some solutions. If you do think that decision weight, the gap is a problem, and there are some solutions that we can do. When we get to the regional breakouts tomorrow, I'll let Kurt end that. But we do have to get out of here because we're on somebody else's time. So I appreciate the panel. Y'all get a panel round of applause.
Really quickly before everyone leaves, and excuse me really quickly, these mics are horrific and you can't really hear unless everyone's being quiet. So let's get excited. You've been invited to get quiet.
You can hear me clap once.
Yes. Thank you so much. Great job today, guys. Let's clap it up for yourselves. Two things just for housekeeping so that everybody can be on the same page, we can all be aware. Tonight there is an event that's happening that's being promoted by Dante. It's at XO Lounge. I believe it starts at 11 and it's free before 12, and I think it's like $10 or $15 after the 12 o'clock hour. There will be a mini ball that will be happening there, which starts around 12:30. Okay? That's that. Additionally, tomorrow breakfast starts at 8 a.m. until 9 p.m. So if you want to eat breakfast, 8 a.m.?
Yeah.
If you want to eat breakfast, that is the time that is. And we expect everyone to be in session at 9 o'clock.
I'm just curious. Are we talking about this more tomorrow? Because we didn't touch on the topic tonight.
Exactly. So I'm going to say, that's my next point. During our
this
lunch
your
regional
house.
Session
stop
tomorrow,
being so
vocal. During our lunch regional
you
session
you were too sassy
tomorrow,
with that. That's your problem.
I'm over it.
During the lunch regional session tomorrow, what we're going to do is we're going to allot some time for us to be able to revisit this and make some action plans on how we can close the gap. And then we'll add a little bit more time at the other regional meeting in the end of the day for you to just do your other regional stuff so we can continue this conversation because it is a large thing that we all want to be able to make sure we make some action plans about. Okay?
Get rid of Harold and Audrey and we can close the gap.
Thank you. Any questions? You all have my cell phone.
Okay.
I will be.
We'll be back here live tomorrow, honey. I don't know. It's a long day tomorrow, so I don't know how long I'll be on live with y'all for tomorrow. But it's definitely a long day, honey. It's from 9 to 5. So I don't know how long my phone gonna last, but I'm gonna try to bring it to y'all and give it to y'all, honey. It's shit tomorrow, honey. We here for the shit at DC. It's going down. We bridging the gap. Okay? Hold.